To dedicate the shiur tonight in Shaare, Orah, first to Harav Aaron Vulcan, Ruach Adonai Tenechenu Began Eden, Tzvi Hirsch Ben Mordechai, Ruach Adonai Tenechenu Began Eden, Eliezer Ben Yishayahu David, Ruach Adonai Tenechenu Began Eden, Shemaya Ben Adina, Ruach Adonai Tenechenu Began Eden, also Hatun Hana Bat Mazal Miriam, Ruach Adonai Tenechenu Began Eden, Ruth Bat Rachel, Ruach Adonai Tenechenu Began Eden, and Meira Bat Haim, Ruach Adonai Tenechenu Began Eden, Levdil Ben Ametim Lahaim Rufash Shema, for Sheva Ben Hatun Hana, El Narafan Alo, El Narafan Alo, El Narafan Alo, for Reuven Ben Hatun Hana, El Narafan Alo, El Narafan Alo, El Narafan Alo, for David Binyamin Ben Dova Fega, El Narafan Alo, El Narafan Alo, El Narafan Alo, and for Marcel Bat Fortuna, El Narafan Ala, El Narafan Ala, El Narafan Ala, also for Rufash Emaf, all the Cholim, all the sick people, the Cholim and Cholot amongst the Jewish people, may they have a rapid recovery and return back to their condition 100%. El Narafan Alahem, El Narafan Alahem, El Narafan Alahem. In the Zechut of the Torah, we're going to learn tonight. So open up Shaare Orah. We're up to page Mem Zayin. I think I might have sent that about 2 weeks ago. Or I think I sent maybe some last week as well. But Mem Zayin we're on, 47 in the Hebrew. So it says over there we're on Yud Chet, which is below the lines on the bottom. So it's talking over here, Shlosha Shemot Mechuvanim, that there are three specific names. We've already reviewed this. Now, it's very, very important as part of learning, especially any type of limud, but especially this limud, is you're going to see there's a lot of repetition. And that's very, very important. Even in the above the line, the book itself has repetition. And that's why often the rabbi in the bottom will cite something he's going to talk about later on. Because this book, like many of these types of books, as you read further on, it clarifies some of the things that you read early on. So repetition is a very important part of learning, because that's how people remember things. By repeating things is how you remember. And since this limud is somewhat challenging from its topical information, repetition is very, very important. So it says over here, Shlosha Shemot Mechuvanim, Shlosha HaShemot Elu Mechuvanim Keneged Da'eses Sefirot Shenehlakim L'Gimbal V'Chinot. It says over here that there are three names, there are three specific names. Of course, he's talking about the names of Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, Yud Kei Vav Kei, and Aleph Hei Yud Hei. These three names of Hashem, which is three of the seven holy names specifically, these three names are basically a keneged. They are basically in parallel to the three different camps of the Sfirot, which means the Sfirot are divided into three sections. Which means the first section, which in Kabbalistic language is called the Gar, which stands for Gimel Rishonim. Eye keneged Gimel Rishonot Keter Chochma Bina. Those are the first three Sfirot. Keter Chochma Bina. Kehab also, that's their acrostic. Havaya, which is Yud Kei Vav Kei. Keneged Tiferet, which is Vav Sfirot Tachtonot, which are the six Sfirot underneath that, Chesed, Givurah, Tiferet, Netzach, Hod, Yesod. That's the Yud Kei Vav Kei, correspond that, but the majority of that is the Tiferet, and the Tiferet represents the body, if we remember the Komat HaAdam that we talked about a couple of weeks ago, the human form. Of course, there's no physical form in Shemaim. That's the Tiferet, that's the Yud Kei Vav Kei. That's the second aspect, that's the second level. And that's called Ze'ir Anpin, the small face, like we have discussed previously. And Aleph Dalet Nun Yud Keneged HaMalchut HaNikra Nukva. And Aleph Dalet Nun Yud is parallel to the Nukva, which is the female, which is the Malchut and the Shekhinah. Continuing on, HaGimel HaRishonot Nikraim Mochim. The first three Sfirot are called Mochim, which basically means thoughts or minds, because this is potential. If you think about a human action, the first thing that happens in a person's mind is he thinks about doing something. That doesn't mean anything happens. He's thinking about doing something. And then, through the signal that is sent from the brain, through the spinal cord, to whatever limb of the body is going to be active, then the body does the action. But there's the potential, which is nemoach, which is the mind. So the Gimel Rishonot are called Mochim. Similarly, like the brains in the head of a person. We know there's a right brain, there's a left brain, and then again, from the Kabbalistic language, we know in medical there's actually a cerebrum, there's a cerebellum, then there's a brainstem, which is composed of three parts, which is basically the midbrain, pons, and the medulla. But basically, as far as the Kabbalah is concerned, there is the right brain, then there's the left brain, and then there is the spinal cord. That would be the dot. So that would be the right brain, left brain, and the brain stem. That's what he's talking about here. That similarly in the physical body, there's these three aspects in the brain. Similarly, there are three sfirot in the rosh, and that's called the gar, the gimel rishonot. Shem ne'elamim ve'nistarim. And these sfirot are hidden, which means they are potential. Potential is hidden. The job in life is to actualize potential. If you think about it, most of the time when a person has a job, nobody pays you for your potential. You might be able to command a good salary when you start off based on your potential, but no one's going to pay you for potential. You get paid for actual. So see here, the purpose of this world is to take whatever potential and to actualize that potential according to the ways of the Torah and the will of Hashem. So they're called ne'elamim, which means they are hidden, because the brain is encased in a skull, which hides these aspects. So we see the parallel in the physical world. V'yesh bahem kochot atzumim v'niflaim. And he says, and the brain has these the mochim have tremendous, tremendous powers and strength. And if you think about it, the analogy is the human mind. The human mind has an unbelievable amount of ways that it can calculate various things. Le'umat guf adam shehu keneged hashem, le'umat guf adam, this is vis-a-vis the guf, which is the body, shehu keneged hashem sfirot, that is keneged, that is with the six sfirot, she'akochot shebahem mugbalim, that the powers of the six sfirot is limited, just like the limit to how much a person can use their arms. There are some people that might be able to bench press 300 pounds, but nobody can bench press 1,000 pounds, at least not that I know, and certainly not 2,000. So we see that our limbs have a limit, the body has a limitation, whereas the brain, the ability of the brain, it's not really unlimited, but it's practically unlimited. The orot hanhaga hagimel sfirot elyonim, and the light of the sfirot of the elyonim, which is the first three we mentioned, and bayim hasaga mechamat merumatam. So a person cannot really appreciate the depth of the first three sfirot because they're very, very high. That's the keter, the chokhman, the binah. Vehem ya'ir yamot ha-mashiach olam haba. Then he says that these sfirot are going to be revealed in a more understood way in the time of the Mashiach and Olam Haba. Here, Olam Haba, he does not mean Olam HaNeshamot, the world of the souls, where people, after they pass from the world and their body goes in the ground, the soul goes up to the Shamaim. That's not what he's talking about. Olam Haba, he's specifically here referring to Olam HaTechiyah, the world of the resurrection, which is heralded by the coming of the Mashiach. Ve'az yitnaheg ha'olam berachamim elyonim, and then the world will be governed by what's called Rachamim Elyonim, upper mercy, which is the Kechab, the Keter, the Chochman Binah. Those are all mercy. Bishlemot bli rav v'tzimtzum. And they're going to be in Shlemut. They're going to be perfect. Without any Ra or any Tzimtzum. Now, there is no Ra that can rise to the level of the three Sfirot. So before those Sfirot can reveal themselves in the time of the Techiyat HaMetim, the resurrection of the dead, the Malach HaMavet, the Yetzer Hara, has to be slaughtered and killed, which is what's the last stanza of the Chad Gadiah song on Pesach. Ukshemeirim orot elu be'olamenu, and when these sfirot, these higher sfirot, reveal their light, obviously not completely, we can't completely understand it, in our world, b'yud gimel midot rachamim. How do they reveal it? Through the yud gimel midot rachamim, the 13 attributes of mercy, which Moshe Rabbeinu was taught on Har Sinai after Chet HaEgel. Adonai, Adonai, El Rachum, Mechanun, Erech HaPayim, Erech Hesed, Ve'emet, Noser Hesed, La'alafi, Noser Avon, Vafesha, V'hata'av, V'nake. These are the 13 attributes of mercy. These are Rachamim Gimurim, and these are from the Sfirot, the higher Sfirot, Rachamim Elyonot, Ube'or Olam HaTeshuvah, and they are from the world of the Teshuvah. Now, when we think Teshuvah, he's going to talk about this book when he gets to Shaar Chet, the eighth gate. The eighth gate, of course, is the Sfirah of Binah, or the which corresponds to the Partsuf of Ima. That is the Teshuvah. That is called the repentance. And that's why it says in the Talmud, when a person makes Teshuvah, it rises to the Kisei HaKavod. What is the Kisei HaKavod? That's the Binah. So we see the Binah represents the Teshuvah. Mistalakim kol atzimtzumim vehagbalot haklipot vehachataim. And through the Teshuvah, through the repentance, what happens, all the limitations of the Shefa, all the limited abundance that a person has based on their sins, and all the klipot, all the husks, which is, we'll talk about that in the future, he's going to talk about that, and chataim, and sins, all of these things that interfere with the close relationship between man and God, through teshuvah, are cleaned out, are removed, are separated. This is the concept of the teshuvah. Ma she'en ken ha'zayin sefirot ha'tachtonot. But this is not the case with the seven lower spheres, which he is talking about Chesed, Givurah, Tiferet, Netzachot, Yesod, and Malchut, which is the Zeran, Pina, and the Nukva. Nikraim Yemei Olam. These spherot are called Yemei Olam, the days of the world, which means we have Yemei Olam, which is now, and now we have Yemei Olam Haba. That is the Hanhagah of the higher spherot, the Keter, the Chochmah, and the Binah. But right now, we are in the Hanhagah, the government or the leadership of the Sfirot of the seven, which is the six. That's called the Mishpat and the Nukva. Shehem ha-me'irim ha-manigim et hanhagat ha-olam hazeh, olam ha-chomer va-bechira. And these Sfirot, through their shining, they run, they lead, and they run, they govern this world, ha-olam hazeh, which is a world of material, chomer, ve'abichira, and choice. See, the Techiyat HaMetim is also a world of chomer. It's a world of materialism, because the Jewish belief in the resurrection is not a completely spiritual and physical together. But the bechira part is unique about this world. Our world right now, there's bechira, there's choice. In the world of the Techiyah, there is no bechira, there is no choice. Why? Bila ha-mavet la-netzah, because Ra and Mavet and death are going to be removed from the world. Well, if there's no death and there's no Yetzah Ra, then there's no choice. Behanhagah ha-mishpat lefi ma'aseh adam. And this world, everything goes according to the actions of a person, the ma'aseh of an individual, and that's how he, based on his choices, proper choices, of course, bringing more shefa, bringing closeness to God. Improper choices, translated following the mitzvot, not following the mitzvot, bring a person distance from Hashem, which means decrease shefa. Now keep in mind, the shefa doesn't stop from the shamayim. The shefa is always there. The question is, you are impeding the shefa to come to you. The shefa is like a sun that is shining all the time and giving light. As long as, if you think about it, a good analogy perhaps with that would be, if a person takes a plane trip and he takes off when it's a cloudy day. When he takes off, it's all cloudy. He can't see the sun. But when he's at 35,000 feet, what happens? He's above the clouds and it's always sunny up there. There's no clouds that high. So therefore, it's the sun represents, not the, of course, nothing physical, the Shefa, which is always there, but the clouds represents like the sin, which cover the Shefa and prevent it from coming in its full force because of the actions of man. And through a person making behaving properly, what happens is it allows the Shefa to come from the higher Sfirot, the Kechab, which is the Gimel Rishonot, the Gar, through the Zeran Pin, through the middle six, through the Malchut, and then the Malchut receives that Shefa, receives that abundance, and then gives it over to mankind. If a person sins, what happens? He makes a block in that Shefa, doesn't allow it, so it's as if the six Sfirot are like pipes, and by stuffing up those pipes, he prevents that Shefa from coming down, so the Malchut receives less, and since the Malchut receives less, she does not have the ability to give over to those who are beneath her. Continuing on, V'ashefa ha-yored min ha-makor, and the Shefa that comes from the Makor, ha-nikra ensof. So the Makor here he's referring to is the Binah, which is the female. This, remember, Makor has two aspects. That's feminine, Makor. If you think about Parashat Acheret in Kedoshim, when it says if a person has relations with a woman when she's nida, benidat tumata, it says et mekora he'era, which means he revealed her place. So the word makor, mekora, is feminine. So therefore the bina is the makor, but that's the makor elyon, and then the shechina is the makor tachton. So the bina, of course, gives all the shefa that comes from the Ein Sof, yes? And depending on the level of the person's behavior and proper following of the Torah, that allows the malchut to receive that shefa from the bina through the six sefirot, and then the malchut's able to give it over as a makor for us. So it's almost like the bina is the makor for the malchut, and the malchut is the makor of the shefa for us. Of course, all the makor is the Ein Sof, which is the emanation from Hashem. Continuing on, Hayored mina makor nikra Ein Sof mishtashel derech shloshot hashemot ha'elu, which means all of the shefa comes from the Ein Sof. That is the ultimate makor, obviously. And for those who remember in the Tzimtzum is the first aspect of the Ein Sof, the retraction of the Ein Sof, and the Tzimtzum represents the feminine as well. I'm going to leave that alone for now. Continuing on, Dero Shlosha Tashemot, by way of the three names. Which three names? Aleph Hey Yud Hey, that represents the Keter Chochman Binah. Yud Kei Vav Kei represents the six, and then the Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, which represents the Shekhinah, the Malchut. Shemurim al Shlemut HaHanhaga, that these three names basically represent the complete government. Kechol Shasfirot uKechol Shasfirot Elyonot Yoter, Kach Midat Chasdo Yitbarak Gedola Yiter. And the higher the Sfirot are, the higher they are, the more Chesed, the more loving kindness is coming. Which means, we know the Malchut has nothing of her own. She has nothing, only what she received from above. So she has the least amount of Chesed, because she's completely dependent on what comes from above. Shem Eyeh Kenege Shlosha Sfirot Elyonot. So the name Aleph Hey Yud Hey corresponds to the first three sefirot, the Keter, the Chochmah, and the Binah, Shehem Rachamim Elyonim, which is a mercy, exalted mercy, Lavi Et Ha'olam L'Shlemuto, to bring the world to its Shlemut. Anybody studies the Ramchal knows his big, what he talks about is the Shlemut. If you read Derech Hashem, and if you haven't read it, I would encourage you to study it. The Ramchal talks about the world is going to the Shlemut. The goal of the world is the perfection. That's why we call Tikkun Olam, correcting of the world. And the goal is to achieve that perfection. And when we achieve that Shlemut, that's called Tehiyat HaMetim. That's the resurrection of the dead. So since that's Shlemut, what does that mean? Now that's governed by the Sfirot, the first three Sfirot that represent Shlemut. Ultikuno leviur hara leatid lavo. And of course, in the tikkun of the world that we're in now, and the removal of the Ra, the destruction of Ra, that's going to happen in the time of the resurrection. Bachasadim gedolim bematanat hinam. And this is through chasadim gedolim in what's called matanat hinam, which means a free gift. The rachamim that comes from the first three sefirot is regardless of whether or not the people down below deserve it or not. When there's a revelation of those three sefirot, when there's an emanation from those sefirot, then there's loving kindness that comes to this world regardless of deserving or not deserving. And that's the concept of matanat hinam. And if anybody remembers, Moshe Rabbeinu, when he wanted to go into the land of Israel, it says, Va'et Hanan el Adonai ba'et ahilemor. What is the word Va'et Hanan? From the Lashon of Matanat Hinam. If I'm not mistaken, that's what Rashi says over there. Matanat Hinam, which means despite the fact that Moshe Rabbeinu deserved, what was he asking for? Matanat Hinam. We see that entire episode as a reference to the fact that Moshe Rabbeinu wasn't just praying to go into the land of Israel. He was praying to bring the Tehiyat HaMetim then. And that's what Hashem said, no, they're not ready for that yet. There's still time for that because of the sin of the Miraglim. But nevertheless, that's what's Vayet Hanan. And if you look, he's going to talk about in this book here, there's a hint to that. Because anytime you see in the Torah, or in the Tanakh for that matter, the name Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, followed by Yud Kei Vav Kei, but the Yud Kei Vav Kei is not read as Amonai, but it's read as Elohim. as it says over there, Adonai Elohim atachelot aleharot et avdecha. Over there, what does it say? Aleph, Dalet, Nun, Yud, and then Yud, Kei, Vav, Kei. But the letters, the vowelization of the Yud, Kei, Vav, Kei over there is Elohim. The Aleph, Dalet, Nun, Yud, we've already learned, represents Malchut. That represents the Nukva. Yud, Kei, Vav, Kei, when it has the vowels of Elohim, represents the Binah. Okay? And there's many reasons for that. Suffice to say that the Binah, There's no din in the Binah. There's no judgment. But in that Sfira is the root of judgment. Because if you think in the Koma and all the Sfira as they're lined up, right underneath the Binah is the Givurah. So the root of the Givurah of the, which is of course the Sfira of the din, that root of the Givurah is in the Binah. So the beginning of the Givurah is in the Binah, but Binah is all Rachamim. And that's why it's Yud Kei Vav Kei, but its letter, the vowelization is Elohim. To let you know, it's the root of the Dinim. And the reason why it says Amon Aleph Dalet Nun Yud Elohim, that's letting us know something called Hit Atruta Letata, which means we are doing something that is going up. When it's the other way, often sometimes in the Tanakh you'll see Yud Kei Vav Kei with the vowelization of Elohim, and then afterwards Amonai, Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, that is It Arota De Ela. That is that the abundance is coming from the Shamayim direct, it coming from Shamayim to the Malchut. This, when it's the other way, when it's the way Moshe Rabbeinu was asking, he's asking from below up, which means we are doing things to bring this to draw the Shefa. Anyway, I may have said too much. Shem Havaya, the Shem Yud Kei Vav Kei, Keneged Ze'er Anpin. The name Yud Kei Vav Kei is like the Ze'er Anpin, which is the sixth. Shehi Hanhagat HaMishpat, that this is the government of judgment, of Mishpat, or justice. And that's the concept of Tzion b'mishpat tipadeh. Tzion will be redeemed through judgment. Shemanhiga et ha'olam lefi ma'aseh ha'tachtonim. That the world is run according to the deeds of the people that live in the world, meaning us. V'nikret midat ha'rachamim, and that's called midat ha'rachamim. She'chesed mishtatef imadin. When the chesed, which is the sphere on the right, is participating with the din, la'akel l'mateket ha'din, to sweeten or to lighten the judgment from the Givurah, ulefi shehanagat ha'chesed rachamim shel hanagat Hashem Havaya ketana, and since the hanaga of the chesed rachamim of the Shem, of the name Yud Kei Vav Kei, is smaller, Yotel Lechen Nikred Ze'er Anpin. It's called small-faced, as opposed to Arich Anpin, which is long-faced, which is the Keter, that's the Partsuf that represents the Keter. The Arich Anpin is basically unlimited Rachamim, whereas the Ze'er Anpin is limited Rachamim. And if you think about it, it's a Remez, which he's going to talk about in this book when we get to the seventh gate, that what is the name that corresponds to the Chesed? Yud Kei, which is the first two letters of the Yud Kei Vav Kei. That represents the Chesed. And Givurah, of course, is Elohim, written as its spell, Aleph, Lamed, Hey, Yud Mem, Elohim. That is the Givurah. So he's talking here about the Chesed, which is the Yud Kei, the Hey, Yud Hey, which is the Chesed, mixing with the Elohim, okay? And that brings Din, but with Rachamim together, with mercy, with loving kindness. Lumata Chesed Rachamim Ha'elyonim Ha'merubim Shekrim Arichampin. And this is vis-a-vis the Chesed that comes from the higher Sfirot, which is called Arichampin, which is long face, that's the Keter, that's unlimited Rachamim. Ve'anukva hi kula din. But the Nukva, which is the Malchut, is complete din, meaning there is no chesed there. The only chesed that the Malchut can receive is what she gets from above, but it's all din. The lefi shehi, which means din, means receiving, and chesed is giving. That's really the understanding here, that chesed is a giving, and a din is a limitation that is receiving. Because why? The Malchut is responsible for, basically runs the world, okay? Reveals the Malchut of Hashem in the world. That's the purpose of the Shekhinah. Ba'olam, u'ma'anishalo re'retzono. And she punishes those who are against the will of Hashem. That's the concept of the Malchut. Okay. Anybody have any questions on what we've said so far before we go to page Memchet?
Say, which diagram should we follow?
Okay, as far as we're on page Memchet, 48. There's no diagram there. We have to learn that diagram and know it in our head. You know, the Sfirot have two different ways. I don't want to get into too much detail. It's going to confuse people that didn't participate in some of the previous Shiurim. But there's the Igulim and the Yosher. 98% of the Kabbalah is talking about the Yosher. It's not talking about the Igulim. The Yosher is with the three lines, yes? Where you have Keter on top, and then you have the Chochmah on the right, then you have the Binah on the left, then you have the Chesed right underneath the Chochmah, then you have the Gevurah right underneath the Binah, then you have the Tiferet, which is in the middle, then you have the Netzach, which is right underneath the Chesed, and then you have your Hod, which is right underneath the Gevurah, and then you have the Yesod, which is right underneath the Tiferet, and then you have the Malchut. That shape, that is basically called the Sfirot HaYosher, the lines, because there's a line of Chesed, which is on the right, there's the line of Din, which is on the left, and then there's the line of Rachamim, which is in the middle. So he's talking here about the line of Rachamim, which is the Keter, the Tiferet, and the Malchut. Keter corresponding to Aleph Hey Yud Hey. Tiferet corresponding to Yud Kei Vav Kei, and Malchut corresponding to Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. Okay, moving on to page Memchet, above the line. Okay? Continuing on in the Shaare Orah. B'shem Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, the Shem of Ammonai, who otsar shebo kol tachsise ha-melech. Though the name Aleph Dalet Nun Yud is Otsar. It's a treasure house. It's a storage house. That's an Otsar. Why? It's something you put things in. That's the Malchut. That represents receiving. That represents the female. That's the Shekhinah. This is Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. V'hu ha-parnas ha-gadol al kol ha-nivraim kulam. And the Malchut is referred to, or the Shem Aleph Dalet Nun Yud is the Parnas. The Parnas is the one who sustains. Why? Because all of the Shefa that comes to this world comes derech of the Malchut, comes through the Malchut, which means it all comes from above. Malchut has nothing on her own. Based on the behavior of the people below, Shefa is drawn from the Makor, which is the Ein Sof, through the Sfirot, down to the Malchut, where it's received. And then what does the Malchut do? She gives it over to this world. That's why the Malchut is also called HaParnas HaGadol. Okay? And this is where the concept of Parnasa comes from. Let's do this again. So the Malchut, okay, I'll give you an example. I think we may have talked about this before, but let's review it. Okay? The concept of masculine is giving. The concept of feminine is receiving. Just think about the action between husband and wife when they're together, and it's very, very clear. Right now, what does that mean? Or when a man goes out and earns and brings home wheat, the Gemara says, well, he goes home wheat. Does she give him wheat to eat? No. So the purpose of the female or the feminine is to take what is received from the masculine, break it up, improve it, and then give it over. So in the classical analogy in a family, again, not to be sexist, husband goes out, brings home money, brings home parnasa, gives it to his wife. She does what she needs to do. She breaks it up into pieces, cooks it, and then she gives it to the children. Okay? This is, so the Malchut, the Shekhinah, that's the concept. So the Shekhinah, the Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, which is the name that corresponds to the Shekhinah, receives from above. She has nothing on her own, only what's received from above, based on the actions of people, us, okay? And then once she's received what she's received, what does she do? She then gives it over to the Tachtonim. She gives it over to the lower worlds. And that's why the Malchut is called the Otsar, the storehouse, which means the receiver of all the Shefa from the Shamayim. And she's also called the Parnas, because what does she do? She gives over from that Shefa to the lower worlds, which is us.
She's also called Bina, right?
No. The Bina is female. That's Sfira is much higher. Yes? So if you think about it, the Bina, Kavyachol, receives from the Keter and the Chochmah, the Ein Sof, the Keter and the Chochmah, and then the Bina gives it over. That's why the Bina is also called Makor, okay? But once again, that's the property of the female. Receive, and then give over. Whereas the Zeranpin are the pipes where that's just where the Shefa goes through. Received in the Malchut, and then given over. And that's why on Shabbat, if you look in fancy Sidurim, ones that have what we call Neshama, what does it say? What is the goal of Shabbat? Oneg, Eden, Nahar, Gan. That's the true, that's the sod of Oneg Shabbat. What is the goal of Oneg Shabbat? Shabbat herself is Malchuta. Boi Shabbat Malketa. Which means Shabbat represents the Shekhinah. So when a person is Shomer Shabbat, what does he do? He draws Shefa from the Bina, which draws, of course, Makor higher up, which is the Ein Sof, through the Zeranpin to the Malchut. That's the Nahar Yotze Me'eden Lashkot Etagan. Let's continue on. And so the Malchut, the Aleph Dalet Nun Yun, is Zan Umifarnes Hakol. So now we understand, which of course he's going to talk about, why in the Shmona Esrei Tefillah, which is a prayer above and more than anything else to receive Shefa from Shamayim, forget about physical reward, that's a separate issue. The goal of the Shmona Esrei is to be having a relationship with Hashem and receiving Shefa from the Shamayim, receiving Shefa through the Sfirot to you. That is the goal, to draw Shefa, to draw abundance, okay? And what do we call, what's the first thing you have to do, like he discussed? You start with a Pasuk, Adonai Sefatai Tiftach Afi Agiti Latecha. Why? Why that Pasuk? You have to start with Aleph Dalet Nun Yun first. Why? Because that's all the Shefa is drawn through that name. Continuing on. That's why that name is called Hazan Umfarnes Hakol. Very Birkat HaMazon, same idea, but we'll leave that alone for now. Bekoach Havayah Shebekirbo, which means the Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, where does the Shefa come? From the Havayah, from the Yud Kei Vav Kei that is contained within her. Now, he doesn't explain this in detail, but the bottom will explain that in detail shortly, but we'll get to that, okay? But just to suffice it to say that the Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, which is Adonai, receives Shefa from the Yud Kei Vav Kei, because the Yud Kei Vav Kei, based on what we discussed, is the Tiferet, which is right above the Malchut. Continuing on. Al Piv Yetzu V'al Piv Yavohu. By way of the P, of the mouth, it comes and it goes, or it comes out and it goes, which means Yetze, Yatza HaShemesh means rise, Uva HaShemesh means set, yes? So the coming of the sun is Yatza, and the resetting of the sun is Yavo. That's from the Gemara, for anywhere to learn Masechet Brachot, like we're discussing. Kol Habaim Lehidabek B'Shem Havaya Yitbarak, which means through the Malchut, everything comes, because she receives, and then she gives. She receives from Yud Kei Vav Kei, and she gives to us. Okay? Continuing on. Ve'en derech v'tzad v'inyan lehidabek b'shem havaya, and there is no way to attach oneself to the name Yud Kei Vav Kei ela al yedei Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, by way of Adonai. Because in order to attach, you have to go to Yud Kei Vav Kei, first you have to go through the first Shaar, which is Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. Ulfichach ze Hashem hu bet otzar. And therefore, that is the name, that's the storage house. Hashem hamiyuchad vehu haechal shebo shochen havaya. And this is the unique name, Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. And this is the hechal. Hechal is also feminine. Hechal, hechalot. Yes? Hechal, which is a vestibule. The hechal shebo shochen havaya. And that's why Aleph Dalet Nun Yud is called the Shekhinah. Why? Because it's the place where Yud Kei Vav Kei is Shochen, which means resting. Let's read the next sentence. We'll go on the bottom and see how does he explain that Yud Kei Vav Kei is Bekirbo, which means it's within it. Let's understand that. Let's read the last sentence. V'chen nikra tamid b'Torah havaya kinui Adonai. And that's why every time now when we read the name Yud Kei Vav Kei in a Sefer Torah, we don't read it as it is written. That is not allowed. As it says in Masechet Sanhedrin, a person who pronounces the name Yud Kei Vav Kei according to the letters, the way it's written, en lo chelak le'olam haba, he has no portion in the world to come. So how do we pronounce Yud Kei Vav Kei? We pronounce it as Adonai. Why do we do that? Klomar, to say, Kol hamavakesh havaya, whoever is looking to connect to the name Yud Kei Vav Kei, yimtza'ena b'shem Adonai. He finds it in the name Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. Now let's look on the bottom and see what he says. This is good stuff. Bekoach havaya shebekirbo. What does this mean? In the strength or the force of the havaya Yud Kei Vav Kei that is within the Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. HaKadosh Baruch Hu mehayet kulam. That HaKadosh Baruch Hu is the Yud Kei Vav Kei. Yes, Kucha Baruch Hu in Aramaic is Kadosh Baruch Hu. That is the Vav. Mehayet kulam. Umehavet kulam bekoach shem havaya. And gives everything life through the name Yud Kei Vav Kei. V'hu k'neshama l'shem aleph dalet nun yud. And Yud Kei Vav Kei is like a neshama for Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. Just like you have a neshama, a human body without a neshama is dead. Yes? So therefore, in order for the body to function, it has to have a soul. So the Aleph Dalet Nun Yud functions how? Through the Yud Kei Vav Kei, which is like a soul for Aleph Dalet Nun Yud in the analogy we're giving. Noten la et kol hakochot lehanhiget hatachtonim. And basically, all of the power of the Malchut, all of the power of Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, comes from Yud Kei Vav Kei in order to give to the Tachtonim, which is us. V'tzerufe Shem Havaya. And Tzerufi means how different ways to combine letters. If you take the name Yud Kei Vav Kei, how many Tzerufim are there? How many different ways are there to combine Yud Kei Vav Kei? So generally, if there are four letters that are not identical, in mathematics, it's 4 factorial. 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. That's how many different combinations one can make of a 4 letters that are all different. If 2 of the letters are the same, since there's nothing that differentiates one hay for another hay, therefore it's four times three, that's it, which is 12. So therefore there's only 12 tserufim when you have the two hays that are the same letter. So Yud Kei Vav Kei has 12 tserufim. There are 12 different ways. If you open up the Sidur, you look at Rosh Chodesh, each Rosh Chodesh has a different way to have in mind the Kavanah for Yud Kei Vav Kei. Each month is a different combination of the letters Yud Kei Vav Kei. He's going to continue on. V'tzerufei Shem Havayahu ha-shorish l'kol l'kochot v'ashinuim b'briyah. And the tzerufim, and the different ways Havayah is combined, the 4 letters are combined to make 12 different combinations. This is basically the root of all of the forces and all of the changes that happened in the Briah, which is the created world. The Shinui Tzerufei Otiyot, and the different combinations of the letters, Im Shinuye Nekudotehem, with different combinations of Nekudot, which of course can make much more combinations, Hem HaShorashim HaElyonim Shel Kol Regei HaShe'ah. This is the Shorashim of every minute of an hour. See what he's talking about. Kmo shekatav b'nefesh ha'chayim, like it's written in the nefesh ha'chayim, v'ze lashono, this is his language. Omnam hadalad yisodim ilain de'inun hashorshin kadmain. There are 4 foundations. There's earth, wind, fire, and water. Those are the 4 different elements, as we would say. Those are called the dalad yisodot, represented by yud K, Vav K. Each one of those 4 letters corresponds to a different one of the Yesodot. Ila'in de'inun ha'shorshin kadmain. These are the roots of everything, yes, because all matter is made up of these 4 elements, yes. And all, this is again, that's the analogy in the physical world. In the spiritual world, it's the same thing. The entire spiritual world is made up of these 4 spiritual elements, which are the 4 letters of Hashem's name, Yud Kei Vav Kei. V'avahan dechula kiniskar b'zohar. And it's all as explained in the Zohar, in Parashat Va'era, shehem shorash kol ma'aseh breshit u'pnimiyot kulam. They are the root of all of ma'aseh breshit, which means the entire creation, and the internal part of everything, which means everything is based on Yud Ke Vav Ke. And when we say Maaseh Breshit, we're not just talking about what happened 5,780 years ago. We're saying Ha'oseh Bechol Yom Tamid Maaseh Breshit, which means the Breshit that is happening all Bechol Yom Tamid. And we'll have a deeper understanding what that means Bechol Yom Tamid shortly. V'hem Dalet Otiyot Havaya Baruch Hu. And these are the four different letters of Hashem's name. Hitmazkutam v'hirkavtam al et kol et varega b'shor shosham eno musag klal. And how this works in detail, nobody really understands. This is beyond human comprehension. It's beyond what we can understand. V'hu yitbarach shemo mehadesham kol rega lafi ratzono. And he is mehadesh the all of these things every minute lafi ratzono. Now, using the term rega, rega we would translate as minute. But it's not talking about a minute, which is 60 seconds. There's a halachic minute. And we'll see what the difference between that is shortly, Be'ezrat Hashem. V'inyan hitmazgutam kol rega. And the concept of the every minute that he's talking about here, hem hataf taf resh pet serufei Hashem, baruch Hashem, al pi hishtanot nikudehem. There are, if you add that up, that's 1,080. Very interesting, 1080p. There are 1,080 different serufim of the Shem, of the name of Hashem, as we'll learn Be'ezat Hashem shortly, okay? What does 1080 correspond to, besides for high definition? Does anybody know what 1080 is?
No.
How many chalakim are there in an hour, in a halakhic hour? 1,080. Those chalakim are what we call halachic minutes, and there are 1,080 of them in every minute. So if you do the math, you'll see it comes out to about for every halachic rega is really 3 seconds. Did I lose everybody?
1,080 halakim in this minute or an hour?
1,080 halakim in an hour. Sorry about that. 1,080 chalakim in an hour. So therefore, a rega, okay, is 60 minutes divided by 1,080, which comes out to about 3 seconds if you add it up. This is from Sefer Yetzirah. Now, just to give a little word about Sefer Yetzirah, this is a book that, according to our tradition, is Miuchas le'Avraham Avinu. And again, this book has been well known amongst the rabbis of the Talmud and of the Rishonim. Rashi mentions it, the Tosafot mention it. If you look at Bezalel, when it says about Bezalel, that he was, it says in the Gemara that he was able to, with he knew the names of Hashem in order to create and destroy worlds, create worlds. And how did he know that? Rashi says, Sefer Yetzirah. Okay? So this book has a lot of sodot. It's a very, very difficult book to understand. The page that I sent you is basically Rabbi Arya Kaplan. He has a English version of the book. Very, very good. I don't think it's available in hardcover anymore, but it's available in soft cover. So if you look at the wheel, you'll see the wheel is divided into 4 parts. Okay? And if you add them all up, all those chalakim come out to 1,080. And that's basically how an hour is divided, okay? Which means the 396 chalakim, which makes up 22 minutes, that corresponds to the Yud Aleph, which we'll see what that means shortly. And then there's the 216 chalakim, which corresponds to 12 minutes, which is the Hey Aleph. And then there's the 252 chalakim, which is 14 minutes, which corresponds to the Vav Aleph. And then there's the other Hey, which is 216 chalakim, which is 12 minutes. When all together, that adds up to an hour, 60 minutes. But in halachic parlance, those will have the chalakim are divided up. If you look at the next page, this is exactly how the name corresponds to each one of the chalakim of an hour. Okay? So you see the vowelization here. So you take an Aleph for the Yud, and the Shuruk, That's how, and then all the different vowelization that one can do. And there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3. There are 36, right? And that corresponds to the Yud, Yud Vav Dalet. And then there's the Hey Aleph, which is the next one, Aleph Hey. And then there's the Vav Aleph Vav, which is the next one, which corresponds to 252. And then there's the Hey Aleph, which corresponds to the 216. If you add up the gematria of all these letters that are here, that's what comes out to the total there. That's why it's the Chalakim. Okay? I don't want to go into detail about this. I would suggest just to review this in what I sent you. Okay? And this is how the entire... So we don't understand. This is just factual information. How this, you know, that the fact that every minute of every day for all time is run by Yudke Vavke. So time, which is the essential ingredient that was first created in the first thing created in the world was time. The first physical creation was time. Bereshit bara Elohim Bereshit what? In the beginning of time, because before Bereshit there was no time. Time is a creation so that the worlds that we live in and the angels have existence. That's time. God's world has no time. That's why Yud Kei Vav Kei represents no time. Hayah Hoveh V'Yeh, all time, no time, which means beyond time. But we are governed by time. And that's why each minute, halachic minute, of the 1,080 halachic minutes that are in an hour correspond to the name of Hashem Yud Kei Vav Kei. Let's continue on. Kaf, Hashem hu bet otzar. So the name, Aleph Dalet Nun Yun, is a bet otzar, a treasure house. That would be the exact translation. Sefirat ha-malchut, the sefirah of malchut, lefi shehi besof ha-eses sefirot, because the malchut is at the end of the 10 sefirot, that's the last one. Nikret bet otzar, she is called a house of, a treasure house. L'chol ha-shefa she-mekabelet ma'aseh sefirot. From all the shefa that she receives from the other sefirot, from the other nine, actually. Keshehi mashpia et ha-shefa lo'olamot she-tachtea. And when the malchut gives over from the shefa that she receives to the worlds that are beneath her, he na'aset lahem l'shoresh. She becomes a shoresh. That's what we talked about above, that she becomes the parnas, the sustainer. So when the Malchut then gives it over to the next level world, she becomes a Shoresh of the world that is below. And that's why Keter Malchut. So what happens basically, I'm not sure he's going to talk about it here, is that when the Malchut then gives over what she receives from the 10 that are, from the 9 that are above her, gives to the lower world right beneath her, then the Malchut becomes the Keter of the next array of Sefirot. Continuing on. וכשהיא משפיעה את השפע לעולמות שתחתיה היא נעשית להם שורש, וכך הוא הסדר של ההשתלשלות והתקשרות העולמות. And this is how all the worlds are connected, through this shefa. The shefa connects the world, because the malchut of the higher world then allows that shefa to go to the next lower world, and that's called the yichud of the olamot, the unification of the world. And remember, for all intents and purposes, there are four worlds. There's the Atzilut, the Briah, Yetzirah, and Asiyah. And the goal is to connect all those worlds together. Or for us to do our part, which is to connect the Malchut with the Shekhinah, the Atzilut, to the Kucha Brichu. And through that, the Shefa comes down and then connects all the other worlds, and that's how we receive the Shefa. It's almost like if a pipe is not connected, then the full sustenance doesn't come through. It sort of leaks out. It's not a great analogy, but that's the same concept. Which means the upper aspect, which is the Malchut, which is the lowest aspect of the above world, connects to the highest aspect, or to the lower world, and that's how they're connected together. Kemashal hanukva, like the female, shemekabelet et kochot ha'ish, that the nukva receives the power of the man, Megaleotam, reveals them, U'mamshicha otam labanim. And then she gives them over to her sons. Lefi shekol hashpot ba'im derech midat ha-malchut. And because all of the shefa comes by way of the malchut, which is the female, the malchut, the lower sphira, haderech la'asigit oro yitbarach. So how is a person supposed to attain shefa from the shama, from God? Who he al yedei yirat shamayim. It's by way of yirat shamayim, v'kabalat ol malchuto, and receiving the yoke of his malchut. Right? We say hakol bidei shamayim chutz mi yirat shamayim, and reshit chokma yirat Hashem, which means yirat shamayim is first. K'mo she'erich b'nefesh ha'chaim, like the nefesh ha'chaim explained, she'aderech la'asig et ha'chokma, the way a person to achieve the chokma, he al yidei yirat shamayim, is only by way of yirat shamayim. And that's why, if you look, whenever Chacham Avadya gives a haskaman, a sefer, he'll say, yirat Hashem hi otzaro. Yirat Hashem is the otzar for the chokma, which means, the greater a person's chokmah, the greater their yirat shamayim. If chas shalom, a person has more chokmah but doesn't have yirat shamayim, there's no place to store it. So the yirat shamayim corresponds to the storehouse, the bet otzar, which is the malchut, which is the nukva. And that's for the chokmah. Kidichtiv, like it says in the pasuk, yirat Hashem hi otzaro. That yirat Hashem hi otzaro, the otzar of the vav. The Vav represents the Torah, represents the Zeranpin, represents Yudke Vavke. So the Yirat Shamayim is the Otsaro, Otsar Vav. That is Otsaro, the Vav, the sixth Sfirot, which, and that's why the Tofar, what does it say in Pirkei Avot? Tiferet Leosea Umin Adam. The goal is to be Tiferet. Well, how is a person supposed to be Tiferet? By learning Torah, because the Torah is Tiferet, that's the Vav. Continuing on, and what's the middle letter of the Torah? Vav. She'en HaKadosh Baruch Hu Mashpi, and also, as long as we're on the subject, that's why with the exception of six places, every single place that begins, every column of the Torah starts with a Vav. And the Vav is the hook that allows one to hook on to what's above. Without the Torah, no dice. But no Torah if there's no Yirat Shamayim. Continuing on, she'en HaKadosh Baruch Hu mashpia chokhmah elyona shel haTorah, that the Torah, Hashem, does not allow the wisdom of the Torah, which is from the Sfirah of the Chokhmah, by the way. The Torah itself is the Tiferet, but the wisdom of the Torah is from the Chokhmah, which is that second Sfirah, yes? What happens, she'en HaKadosh Baruch Hu mashpia does not allow the abundance to come, the influence to come of the Chokhmah elyona, which is the Chokhmah we talked about, the second Sfirah of the Keter. Ela lemish yesh lo osar shel yirah, except to someone who has osar shel yirah, which means if he doesn't have yirat shemaim, he doesn't have any chokhmah. Klomar shechokhmah yona mitgalet rak al yedei midat malchuto yitbarach. So we see that the chokhmah is only revealed by way of the malchut. Shehi kabbalat ol malchut shemaim. That is the concept of yirat shemaim, which is kabbalat ol malchut shemaim. Gadol Torah hamevi lemaaseh. Studying Torah for the purposes of studying Torah is important. But the great Torah that a person learns is when it brings you to Maaseh. Because that's the Gilui of the Torah, is the Maaseh. Of course, a person can be Megaleh, the Torah that's in the head, by teaching it. But the real way to be Megaleh, the Torah, is not just by what's in your head and what's in your mouth, but within your actions, through the mitzvot, Torah mitzvot, the Maasim Tovim. Umidat hayirah hi mashim mevatel atzmo leborei yitbarach. And what is the yirat shamayim? The concept of bitul. A person is mevatel et atzmo. When a person realizes that he is nothing compared to God. Nothing. Therefore, the anava, that is the greatest trait that a person can have, the anava. And that's why the one man who was closest to God and any human being ever was Moshe Rabbeinu. V'ayish Moshe anav mikol ha'adam al shalech p'nei ha'adamah. Why? Because he had the greatest amount of Yirat Shamayim. And that's why it says, when it says in the Ma Hashem Shoel Meimach, in the Parashat Ekev, when it gives the five things that God wants from our life, and the first thing is, ki im li'ir'ah. If only to have yir'ah. What key? So all the men and the rabbis asked, what does it mean, ki'im li'yirah? Yirat Shamayim is huge. Not everybody has it. How can it be? Because for Moshe Rabbeinu, who had so much Yirat Shamayim, he would say, ki'im li'yirah. It's easy. Because he had so much Yirat Shamayim that he worked on, that he thinks that's an easy step. It's not necessarily easy for everybody. But that is the key factor. And that's represented by the Sirah of the Malchut. And that's the Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. And that's why the Tefillah Tzotzot Adonai Sfatai Tiftach Ofi Agiti Latecha. Continuing on. That's the Midat Yirah. That's the Otsar. Himashi Mevatel Atzmo Leborei Yitbarach. And that's the concept of Bitul. That he's Mevatel Atzmo. That he realizes that he's nothing. Umekabel Malchutu Beshlemut. And he receives the Malchut of Hashem in purity. Meaning what? That I'm nothing. And God is everything. So I have to do whatever he says because I'm just a servant because I'm nothing. And that was the mistake of Nadav and Avihu because they went as Ishmachtato. They didn't go in with enough Yirat Shamayim. So what happened? They lost their protection. And when your person goes into the Kodesh Kodashim without protection, God takes them. They die. And that's very close to God, but that's not where their intention was. But because they went in with that Ish Machtato, Esh Zara, which means a strange flame. The strange flame was their presence as opposed to Aharon, where it doesn't say Ish over there, because Aharon was very humble, maybe not as much as Moshe, but not too far away. So he could Yotze v'nichnas to the Kodesh Kodashim and not be affected. And perhaps we can say the same thing about Rabbi Akiva. Why was Rabbi Akiva able to go in Shalom and to come out of the Pardes? Because he was Anav Me'od. Again, no one is as humble as Moshe Rabbeinu, but he had the greatest anava, and that's why he was able to come into the Pardes and come out without. And that's why it's so important for people. And one of the goals of this limud, of studying this, is to develop Yirat Shamayim. There's nothing that develops a person Yirat Shamayim and Emunah and faith greater than studying the Kabbalah. But that means that the more chokhmah a person has, because this is called chokhmah ta'emet, which is the highest level of chokhmah, more yirat shamayim. Lack of yirat shamayim while studying this is very, very dangerous. Continue on. Rak liyot bet otsa lekabel chokhmah. So therefore, a person should always have the yirat shamayim, because that's the bet otsar, that's the treasure house, to receive the chokhmah, to receive the chokhmah. Let's just do kaf aleph to the bottom of the page, and then we'll stop. Ha'echal shebo shochen havaya, the heichal that heichal is shochen, ayidei yichud shem havaya, by way of the yichud of the name havaya, yud kei vav kei, im aleph dalad nud yud, which is yud kei vav kei, that's in the sidur when you see the yud, that's one, right after you look at Hashem's name, it'll say yud aleph, then it'll say hey dalad, then it'll say vav nun, and then it'll say, hey yud. That's what it says there, right? That's the concept of Yichud of Havaya, Yud Kevavke, with Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. Nichnas HaShefa LeOtzar. Then the Shefa comes into the treasure house. Yes, the Shefa, which is in the Shemaim, from above, yes, from the higher Sfirot, comes into the Heichal. The Heichal is the Malchut. Shehu Midat HaMalchut. Vehi Mashpia Shefa Rav LeOlam. And the Malchut gives over Shefa to the rest of the world. Kedipta BaZohar. Like to explain the Zohar in Parashat Teruma. V'ha'echad ganiz tuvya u'barchohi be'otza hanikra hechal, which means ha'echad, which is the echad, which is of course hakuch abrichu, ganiz tuvya is hidden, u'barchohi, and the brachot are be'otzar hanikra hechal. That's called hechal. And if you look at the gematria of the word hechal, what is the gematria of the word hechal? 50, 65, which is Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, 65. V'hu ramuz bepasuk, and this is hinted to in the pasuk, Vadonai beheichal kodsho, Vamonai, which is Yud Ke Vav Ke, beheichal kodsho. Beheichal is a remez Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, that it has to be the Yud Ke Vav Ke, has to be in the Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. And we'll see what he's going to talk about Be'ezrat Hashem next week. B'tikunei Zohar, and in Tikunei Zohar, it says, HaMelech Stam Da Kutsha Brichu. The Melech, of course, is the Kutsha Brichu, the HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Heichal HaMelech Da Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. But the Heichal of the Melech, the Heichal is Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. So the Kutsha Brichu is the Yud Kei Vav Kei. That's the Melech. And the Heichal, the palace of the king, is the Malchut, Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, Salik Lechushban Hechal. And we see Aleph Dalet Nun Yud and the Cheshbon, the Gematria of Aleph Dalet Nun Yud and the Gematria of Hechal is the same. The Itmar, as it says, the Hashem Hechal Kosho Has Mi Panav Kola Aretz. Has, what is Has? Gematria 65. Same as Hechal, same as Aleph Dalet Nun Yud. The Kavana, Shagimatria Shel Aleph Dalet Nun Yud, he samache, kmo hagematria shel hechal, vezera muz bepasuk has mi panav kol aretz. It's hinted to in the pasuk itself that it says has, which means 65. Has gematria shel hechal. Anybody have any questions? No questions.
Hey, Doctor Ross, last time you were saying that the word Shalom is Hashem's name.
Yes.
I don't understand how.
Okay. Let's think about that. In Hebrew, Shalom is spelled Shin,
right.
Lamed, Vav, Mem. Yes?
Yes.
Okay. Take out the Vav. What do you have?
Shin Lamed Mem.
Which means in Hebrew, Shalem. What is Shalem?
Well, depends why Shalem. Depends what you have, what type of vowel is under the Lamed. Could be La, could be Lo.
Give me the word.
Well,
Shalem, having... which means complete. Shalom, which means full. It's all the same thing.
And Shalom is the same?
Well, I'm going to explain. So we're saying if you take Shin Lamed Mem, which is the majority of letters of the word Shalom, yes?
Right.
Basically
right.
Means Shalem, which means perfect. Something that is full is perfect. Okay?
Okay.
A circle
okay.
Is perfect.
Okay.
360
okay.
Degrees, yes?
I got it right.
What makes the circle perfect? The Vav that's inside. So therefore, the word Shalom is Hashem's name. Again, all the words of the Torah are the names of God. We discussed that. Okay, so we have the seven names that can't be erased, yes?
Right.
And those
right.
Seven names, if you rearrange them a little bit, becomes 10. That's what this book is talking about, those 10 names, right? Those are called the names. And everything is based on Yud-Kei Vav-Kei. That's what he discussed in the first, in the introduction, right?
Yes, yes.
But then there's something called Kinuim. Nicknames. Like
okay.
Chanun, Rachum, Merciful, okay. Gadol, right, right. Gibor, Nora. Those are
okay.
All nicknames, okay? That's
descriptors.
And what
right.
Is the Torah? The Torah is describing God's relationship with the world. So
okay.
Every word in the Torah is the name of Hashem. And that's proven from the Gemara. The Gemara brings a pasuk where it says, where do we learn that a person has to make a bracha before he learns Torah, or when he gets aliyah, you have to make a bracha. Baruch atah Hashem elokim melech asher b'chavanu mikol ha'amim v'natan lanu et Torah. Yes? Okay. Where do we learn this from? Where do we learn the concept of making a bracha before learning Torah? There's a pasuk in Ha'azinu. Ki shem Adonai ekra havu godel Elohenu. When you call the name of God,
okay.
Then give godel. What is godel? Give thanks. Give bracha to our God. So all of the Torah is called Shem Hashem. And in Hebrew, ekra, what doesn't mean to read. It's called Kriyat HaTorah. Why is it called Kriyat Shema? Why? Because you are reading what's written. Okay?
Yes.
So all of the Torah is the Shemot of Hashem, based on that Pasuk, because it calls the Torah Shem Hashem Ekra.
Okay.
And that's why everything, so the word Shalom appears in the Torah, therefore it's the name of Hashem. But I gave you the meaning of why Shalom represents why it's also a name of Hashem. What's the meaning? Shalem. And what is when there's Shalom? What does that mean? That people are in agreement with each other. There's no Machaloket.
Okay.
And what is considered sin'ah? When is a Jew guilty of hating another Jew? When he doesn't say shalom three times in a row.
Three times. Means today. Tomorrow.
Which means normally, when I would see someone, I would say hello. I would say shalom. In Hebrew, we don't say hello. There's no halo. That's modern Hebrew. The word is shalom. Okay? And because he did something to me, and I'm upset about it, but I don't tell him about it, okay? If I don't, he greets me and I don't respond three times, or I don't greet him, I'm normal to greet him and say shalom, and I don't, that's called al tisnat achicha b'yavavecha. You cannot hate your fellow Jew in your heart. It has nothing to do with wishing him dead or anything like that. The fact that you don't say shalom. So we see when there is shalom, there is no machaloket. Anything, and what does shalom mean? When two people are together. What is machloket? When two people are apart. God has no parts. So the more people are together, the more they are like God.
Uh-huh. Wow. That's nice, yeah.
One word. That's why Hebrew is called Lashon HaKodesh, the holy tongue. Because the words in Hebrew are deep, deep meanings. And that's another thing that the Kabbalah focuses on. The words of the Torah, what they mean, and not just the words, the letters and the nekudot, everything has deep, deep meaning, and it's just amazing.
Yeah, I wish I learned it earlier. Yeah.
Never too late. Anybody else have any questions?
No, sir.
All right, very good. Baruch Adonai Le'olam Amen V'Amen. Have a good night. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rav. Thank you.
Very welcome. Take care.
You will. Goodbye.